David. I'm one of the elders here at KC Christian Reformed Church, and on behalf of us, we'd like to welcome you, whether you're a member or whether you're a visitor. It's great to have you along. There are a couple of announcements before we get started. Yesterday was our National Day of Thanks, and during this month, we have been encouraging each other to thank God and each other in what God has done for us as individuals, as families, and also as a church body. And it's just great to reflect on that. If you want to, there's some stuff in the newsletter. Feel free to read those. Today is Pentecost Sunday, where we remember and thank God for the pouring out of His Spirit on His followers and fueling the mission for that early church. This Wednesday is our prayer meeting. The first being at 6 a.m. and the other one being at 12 p.m. It'd be great to have some people attending there too. Last but not least, we'd like to welcome Pastor Crosby, a long-standing pastor within our denomination, and it's always good to hear his voice. God greets us today with these words from John chapter 4. Jesus told her, the Samaritan woman, "Believe me, woman, an hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, because salvation is from the Jews. But an hour is coming and is now here when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Yes, the Father wants such people to worship Him. God is spirit, and those who worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth." And God greets us today from Revelations chapter 1. "Grace and peace to you from the one who is, who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has set us free from our sin by his blood, and made us as a kingdom, priests to the God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen." Congregation, let us worship God. And let us do that in song with 10,000 reasons.
Sing like never. Thank you, David, for welcoming us this morning. Thank you to our music team for also leading us in song. Let's come to the Lord in a time of prayer. My name is Michael. I'm the pastor here at the church, and thank you for joining us in worship today. Let's come to the Lord in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we say, hallowed be your name. Lord, you are good and great, and Lord, we adore you. And Lord, your word says that we can bring our prayers and approach the throne of grace with confidence, Lord, because we have Jesus Christ, our merciful High Priest, interceding on our behalf. So, Lord, we want to bring our points of thanksgiving to you. And right now, we want to thank you for this day, Pentecost Sunday, where we remember the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on your people. Thank you, Lord, that the Spirit fueled the mission and the spread of the church. Thank you, Lord, that that same power, the Holy Spirit, lives in the believer to comfort us and to counsel us. And Lord, we pray that many of us who are anxious, who are lonely, who are suffering from illness and mental illness, Lord, that we will be comforted and counseled by the Holy Spirit. Lord, those who are lost, Lord, that they would be saved, that the Holy Spirit makes us born again. So, Lord, we thank you and we celebrate the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on us, your people. Thank you, Lord, that yesterday could be the National Day of Thanks in Australia. Lord, where we can recount our blessings by the Lord and thank you and thank one another practically. Thank you, Lord, that our church has been doing that this past month. And Lord, may we not wait for a National Day of Thanks to do this, but Lord, that you will change us into a family that has an attitude of gratitude. And Lord, we will thank you each day. And Lord, we will practically appreciate and thank one another. Lord, thank you that you are Jehovah Jireh, the one that provides for us. And Lord, as we worship you through our giving, Lord, we pray that you will use these monies for the furtherance of your local church, firstly, and also for the giving through our second offering to the work of our denomination's church planting task force. Lord, we pray for our Pakenham brothers and sisters. Lord, as they scatter the gospel seed in Pakenham, Lord, we pray for Pastor Richard and the leadership and the members there. Lord, that these monies will be used for the furtherance of your kingdom there in Pakenham. Thank you also, Lord, that we can bring our needs to you. Lord, we pray for those who need your healing hand. Father, we think of Graham as he continues to have chemotherapy to treat his pancreatic cancer. Thank you, Lord, for the good news that we can have this week, that his blood count levels have improved. So, Lord, we pray for Graham. We pray for Tammy and the children as they undergo these difficult days. Father, we thank you also that we can pray to you to put an end to this virus that is gripping and killing so many around the globe. We pray for those many thousands who have lost loved ones. Lord, we pray for our own church family who are grieving. We think of Liz and her family in Hobart. Lord, as Liz's sister-in-law, Tony, passed away this past week. Father, we pray for Liz and Bert and the rest of the family as they prepare for the funeral service this week. Lord, thank you also that we can confess our many sins to you in prayer. And Lord, like David in Psalm 51, Lord, we pray that you will create in us a clean heart. Father, that you will renew a steadfast spirit within us. Lord, do not banish us from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from us. But Father, restore unto us a joy of your salvation. Lord, sustain us by giving us a willing spirit. And thank you, Lord, that when we repent, when we turn from our sin, and when we turn to you, Lord, that you promise to forgive us and to cleanse us from all of our sin. So, Lord, thank you that we can pray all these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. As response to your amazing grace, God's amazing grace, we want to respond in song, recounting how God's amazing grace has saved wretched sinners like you and me. How God has brought us from darkness into his marvelous light. So let's sing about God's grace that has saved us. Thank you.
Today's reading comes from Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 13. When the day of Pentecost had arrived, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like that of a violent rushing wind came from heaven, and it filled the whole house where they were staying. They saw tongues of flames of fire that separated and rested on each of them. Then they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in different tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were Jews staying in Jerusalem, devout people from every nation under heaven. When this sound occurred, a crowd came together and was confused because each one heard them speaking in his own language. They were astounded and amazed, saying, "Look, aren't all those who are speaking Galileans? How is it that each of us can hear them in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, those who live in Mesopotamia, in Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the magnificent acts of God in our own tongues." They were all astounded and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But some sneered and said, "They're drunk on new wine."
It's a wonderful opportunity for us to have my dad, Crosby, Pastor Crosby, preach for us today on Pentecost Sunday. And before he preaches, I'd like to pray for him. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much that we can open your word and, Lord, recount the first events of Pentecost. Lord, the outlining, the outpouring, and the outworking of the Holy Spirit. Father, we pray for Dad as he preaches your word, as he proclaims the good news about Jesus, Lord, that is powerful unto salvation for everyone who believes. So, Lord, we pray for an extra portion of your presence to be with Dad as he preaches and proclaims your word. So, Lord, thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Today is Pentecost Sunday, and our focus will be on what Pentecost means to the church, and more personally, what does Pentecost tell us and teach us about the Holy Spirit. This morning, I would like to look at God's Word as we find it in the book of Acts. Chapter 1, chapter 2, and chapter 4. The book of Acts has been called the Acts of the Apostles, but there are others who have given it a more apt description by calling the Acts of the Holy Spirit. The day of Pentecost and Pentecost Sunday is a very important day that we remember, a very significant event that took place in the fulfillment of God's plan of salvation for humanity. Christmas, Good Friday, and Easter are three events that are celebrated in the church's calendar that we all remember and we celebrate by being in church. Ascension Day is on a weekday, and that is not as well attended for the services that we have. Pentecost Sunday, on the other hand, is a Sunday, and today we gather with God's people to be able to investigate and to check what God's Word tells us about this very, very important event. I know we are living in times when we don't have a church audience, but this is another way in which God works. Even though the church is closed and the doors of the church are closed, we don't meet in the church, but thankfully God takes the message to the homes of his people, just like was done in the early church, where they met in their homes and they were able to worship the Lord in that way. So my prayer is that you, in your own home, as you listen and watch this service, will be blessed as we look at the Word of God in these passages. My message this morning is, what does the Bible tell us about the person and the ministry of the Holy Spirit? So my first point is that the Bible outlines about the Spirit, outlines the truth about the Spirit. Secondly, that Acts chapter 2 describes for us the outpouring of the Spirit on the early church. And Acts chapter 4 gives us just one example of how that Holy Spirit is at work in the lives of the church of the New Testament, and we hope in the life of the New Testament church even in the 21st century. So let's look at Acts chapter 1, verses 1 to 8, which tells us a little bit about the truth about the Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 1, we are told there in verse 4 of chapter 1, on one occasion while he was eating with them, that's the resurrected Lord, he gave them, his disciples, this command, and he says, do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Now Jesus tells his disciples that even while he was with them, before his death and his resurrection, he taught them about the Spirit and about what the Spirit was going to do. And this is very graphically described for us in John's Gospel, chapters 14, 15, and 16. We find here that Jesus describes and identifies the person of the Spirit. The identity of the Spirit is that he is a person. He's not a thing, he's not an object, but he is the third person of the Holy Trinity. We have God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In John chapter 15 and verse 26, we read this. When the Counselor comes, that is the Holy Spirit, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth, who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. So we find that the Holy Spirit is in fact God. He's the third person of the Trinity, and he proceeds from the Father and the Son. The Son proceeds from the Father, but the Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. And this brings about the unity and the community of the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The second thing we find about the identity of the Spirit is not only that he is a person, but Jesus says that he is another counselor, or another comforter, or in John chapter 1, 1 John chapter 1, chapter 2 and verse 1, he is called the advocate. Now all these three words, the comforter, the counselor, and the advocate, is translated one word. It's the Greek word parakletos, or the English word paraclete. So some translations use it as the counselor, others the comforter, and John talks about this person as the advocate. Now the important thing here is that Jesus says to us in John, that Jesus is going to send us another comforter. Now in the Greek, the word another or other is used with two words. One is the word that is used here, and the other is another word which is used in the English language called heteros. One is allos, which is used here, and the other is heteros. Allos is another of the same kind, whereas heteros is another of another kind. So what Jesus is saying here is, this Holy Spirit that is going to come is me. The Spirit is my presence with you. And this is why Jesus says also in John, I am not going to leave you as orphans, but I will come to you. In the end of Matthew's Gospel, in the Great Commission, Jesus says, all authority is given unto me in heaven and on earth. Go into all the world and make disciples of all nations. And lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the age. In John's Gospel, Jesus is preparing his disciples for his separation from them. And he tells them, it is important for me that I go away. For if I don't go away, the promised gift will not come. So it is in this way that Jesus reassures them that even though he goes away physically, he is going to be with them spiritually. And this will happen only when the Holy Spirit is given to them in due course. Now, what does the Spirit do? The Spirit testifies to Jesus and about Jesus. Jesus calls the Holy Spirit the Spirit of truth. And in John chapter 14 and verse 6, Jesus says, I am the truth, I am the way, and I myself am the life. So here again we see the unity of Jesus and the Spirit. Jesus calls himself the truth, and the Spirit that he sends and comes from the Father as a gift is called the Spirit of truth. So this Holy Spirit, his ministry is to testify that what Jesus has said is the truth. And he testifies into our lives that we need to accept Jesus because he is the truth, the way, and the life. Now we turn to check Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. He talks to the disciples and he says this, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So the ministry of the Spirit is that when he comes, he empowers the believers to be witnesses of the truth. So the Holy Spirit witnesses about the truth, that is Jesus, but he comes and he empowers us, even as he empowered the disciples, to be able to witness, to bear testimony to the fact that Jesus is the truth. Much more can be said about the Holy Spirit, who he is, and what he does. But for the purpose of our message on Pentecost Sunday, it is important for us to just grasp the truth of this, that the Holy Spirit that we celebrate is a person, and he has a mission to accomplish in the church and in our lives. He is the wonderful counselor who testifies to Jesus, who is called the wonderful counselor, the Prince of Peace, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father. We move on from there to Acts chapter 2. In Acts chapter 1, Jesus gives us the promise of the coming Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 2, we find the fulfillment of that promise. We find Luke's description of the outpouring of the Spirit in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 13. If you have your Bibles, I'd like you to turn to Acts chapter 2 and look at that passage, as I will be pointing out a few truths for us to grasp. The first thing that I'd like to point out as we read in verse 1 of chapter 2, Luke says, when the day of Pentecost came. Pentecost didn't only happen in the New Testament. The day of Pentecost was actually a feast that was observed by the Jews, prescribed for us in the Old Testament in Exodus and in Leviticus. It was one of the great feasts that the Jews observed. The feast of Pentecost, or the Feast of Weeks. The word Pentecost comes from the Greek word meaning 50. It marks 50 days after the Passover. It is also called the Feast of Harvests, because at this time the Jews brought their first fruits and they dedicated that to the Lord. It was on this day that God chose to fulfill the promise that he had made and that Jesus had made about the coming Holy Spirit. It was not a coincidence that it happened on the day of Pentecost. It was the day of first fruits. And as we read, after what happened on the day of Pentecost, truly it signified what a great harvest there was yet to be reaped when the Spirit does his work in his church. Not only was it a historical event recorded on the pages of Scripture as a historical occurrence, but it was also a phenomenal, redemptive, historical event. Now, what do I mean by that? It was a historical event, but it had redemptive significance. In other words, it was a part of God's redemptive plan of salvation. It was not just an addition, but it was a part of God's unfolding of redemptive history. And on this day, something phenomenal happened. So that's why I call it a phenomenal, redemptive, historical event. Now, what do I mean by the word phenomenal? You get the English word phenomenon, or the plural phenomena. And those were strange, unnatural, supernatural events, phenomena. Now, on this Pentecost day in Acts chapter 2, there are three phenomena that are described. One is the sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven. The sound like that of a violent rushing wind. That was the first phenomenon. Why wind? In the Bible, within the Old Testament and the New Testament, the word wind is used to describe the spirit and breath. Wind or the spirit. One word. In the Greek, it is the word pneuma. In the Old Testament, it's the word ruach. So whether you read it as wind or spirit, it's the same thing, because wind was a symbol of the Holy Spirit. When Jesus talks to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, he tells Nicodemus, you must be born again. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit, and that which is born of the flesh is flesh. Don't be surprised when I tell you, you must be born again. Nicodemus, with all of his theological knowledge, how can I be born again? Can I enter into my mother's womb and be born a second time? Then Jesus says, the wind blows wherever it pleases. You can hear the wind, but you can't see the wind. So also is one who is born of the Spirit. The Spirit is invisible. You can't see the Spirit, but you can see the effects of the Spirit. You can hear the Spirit. And that's why this tells us that when the Spirit came on the church gathered there in Acts chapter 2, they heard a violent, rushing, mighty sound. The Spirit is powerful. It's powerful. And the Spirit blows wherever He wills. And we see the effects of that in what transpires on that first day of Pentecost. The second phenomenon is this. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. Here again, fire is a symbol of God in the Old Testament. It's a sign of the divine presence. I'm reminded of Moses' encounter with God at the burning bush. He was in the wilderness looking after sheep. He saw this bush burning, but it wasn't getting burnt. A strange phenomenon. And then he went to the bush to find out what this was, and God spoke to him and says, Moses, take the shoes off your feet, for the place you are standing is holy ground. And it was there that God revealed to Moses that he was the great I Am. We find that fire in the Old Testament was also a sign of God's actions when on Mount Carmel, Elijah's sacrifice was quenched by a fire that came down from heaven. And also when Elijah was translated into heaven, he was taken up in chariots of fire. Fire signifies the presence of God. And if the Spirit is God, here God's presence is symbolized by these tongues of fire that came and sat upon each one of them. So this is another way in which Luke tells them that the Spirit is come. He has come. The promised Spirit has come in the sound of a rushing mighty wind, or in tongues of fire. And now the third phenomenon is that they spoke in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. The wind they heard, but they couldn't see. The tongues of fire they saw. And the speech they heard. When the Spirit came upon them, they began to speak in other tongues. The word is glossolalia. Another word is languages. That's the same word that is used later on when they said, we hear them speak in our own language, in our own tongues, the wonderful works of God. So these people were gifted with the Holy Spirit, and they were able to proclaim the wonderful works of God in their own languages. We need to observe here that very clearly the word tongues, or the speaking in tongues, is in Acts chapter 2, particularly it is spoken languages. Luke tells us that the people who were gathered in Jerusalem on that day were people from all areas of the dispersion. From Persia in the east to Rome in the west, and all over in between, they had gone, they had spread, they had been dispersed, but they came back to Jerusalem for the Feast of Pentecost. They came back to Jerusalem for educational purposes, for business purposes. They all came back. But on this day, whatever language they were accustomed to speak, they spoke. And the others heard them and says, this is amazing. They were all Galileans, but we hear them speaking in their own languages the wonderful works of God. This was the miracle that took place on the day of Pentecost, a miracle that was used by the Lord to open the floodgates of the gospel. And it reminds us here that when Jesus says to them in Acts 1, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea and Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. The book of Acts starts at Jerusalem, crosses the Jewish boundaries, and goes into Samaria, goes beyond Samaria into the Gentile world with Cornelius, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth through Paul, ending up in Rome. So we see here that the book of Acts virtually is an expansion and an amplification of what Jesus promised in Acts 1:8. And the Holy Spirit is given across the border to people of all nationalities and peoples and tongues. And so we find that the global phenomenon has been accomplished, that the gospel goes global, or as we use today, goes viral. Friends, we are living in the 21st century. We are living in the era of the Spirit. We are living at a time when the Spirit is at work. We may think we have restrictions, we may think we have isolations, we may think that the church's doors are closed, but believe you me, God is opening other windows. One door may be closed, but there are other windows by which people are hearing in their own languages the wonderful works of God. That Jesus is the way, the only way. Lovingly he calls us, so the scriptures say, whosoever will, let them come today. The blessed Jesus is the only way. It was a historical event. It was a phenomenal, redemptive, historical event. It was also a prophetical event. Now, when these people heard this, they said, what does this mean? They were trying to get a rational explanation for what was happening. And there were some, like there is in every crowd, the serious and the jocular. And the unbelievers, the cynics and the skeptics made fun. And they said, they have had too much to drink. Peter got up and said, These men are not drunk. It is only 9 o'clock in the morning. What has happened and what you have seen happening is not something caused by excess of alcohol, but it is a phenomenon that is called because of an excess of the Spirit being outpoured. And it says this is now a fulfillment of the prophecy of Joel made hundreds of years ago in Joel chapter 2, which says, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my Spirit on all people. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. So we see, brothers and sisters, friends, that what happens on the pages of Holy Scripture, what happened on the day of Pentecost, is God at work. What is prophesied is fulfilled. It takes hundreds of years for that fulfillment to come to pass. But it has happened, and now that is even valid for us today. Because when people minister under the power and the fullness and the dynamic of the Holy Spirit, God does miraculous works. Every human heart that is hardened by unbelief can be broken by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's the message of Pentecost. The last thing I'd like to point out about this Pentecost event that took place in Acts chapter 2 is that it was a redemptive event. Now, Acts chapter 2 tells us about the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. It tells about us about the reaction of the people, but it also tells us about the sermon that Peter preached. Verse 14, Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Who is this Peter? This Peter is the same man that was so timid that he denied his Lord. He was ashamed to say that he was a part of the following of Jesus. But this Peter is now filled with the Holy Spirit, is transformed by the Holy Spirit, and this same Peter who was once a coward, who denied Jesus, now is emboldened by the Spirit and testifies that Jesus is the way. He preaches a very powerful and a very courageous sermon. In verse 36, he says this, therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. He had the spiritual guts to point the finger at these Jews and say, you were the people that crucified Jesus. And then we read this in verse 37. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart. In other words, their heart was torn inside out. And they said, what shall we do? Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. After this great sermon was preached, we find that there is an urgent plea that Peter makes. He says he pleaded with them and saying, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. And those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 people were added on that day. I would so wish that the Lord would accomplish such a redemptive event this Pentecost Sunday. Some doubted, some made fun of him, some still continue to live in disbelief. But through the working of the Holy Spirit on that day, using the words of Peter, 3,000 were added. And this is why I said Pentecost was a day that they brought the first fruits of their harvest in dedication, expecting a great harvest. And God doesn't disappoint them. On this day, the Spirit brought a harvest of 3,000 people on that day. In Acts chapter 4, we find 5,000 added. And friends, people might think that the Christian church is declining. But I want to believe that the Christian church is increasing. Behind closed doors, in countries where the word is suppressed, where Christians are being persecuted, the church is growing. And that's the work of the Holy Spirit. From Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth, the word is going out, and the Spirit is using that word to bring about the harvest of souls. Friends, have you met Jesus? Have you believed in him to be the way, the truth, and the life? Come to him today and be saved. We move on from there to Acts chapter 4, which very quickly I'll give you as just one example of how the Spirit is outworking in the lives of his church. The outlining of the truth about the Spirit, the outpouring of the Spirit in Acts 2, and now the outworking of the Spirit in Acts chapter 4. In chapter 3, Peter and John are going to the temple to pray. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, there's a crippled man there, at the gate of the temple, and he looks to them and says, "Can you give me something?" And he was expecting something from Peter and John, but they said, "Silver and gold have I none, but in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He was crippled from birth, but in an instant, through the power of the Spirit of God and in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Peter and John gave healing to this man. A great miracle. Luke calls it a sign. And this sign was used by the Lord to bring people to a greater awareness of who Jesus is. But there were the Sanhedrin who were not very happy that these people were coming and preaching about Jesus and his resurrection. So they bring both of them before the Sanhedrin and says, "Look, we want you to go away from this place, but we want to give you a slap on the wrist and say, please don't talk or preach anymore in the name of Jesus." Now Peter, we are told there in verse 13, when they saw the courage of Peter and John, and they realized that they were unschooled and ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. Peter and John were ordinary fishermen. The people involved in this miraculous sign were people that hadn't any theological degree, The word means that they were uneducated, unschooled. These men were just ordinary people. They had not been trained. They had not been given any course of instruction. But this is what happens when God uses people. I'm not saying that you shouldn't be educated. I'm not saying that you shouldn't strive to get greater education and information. But all I'm saying is that getting a degree is not the only thing that is important in life. It's to be an instrument that God uses, that God can use anyone, whether he's schooled or unschooled. The important thing is that they were academically unschooled, but spiritually they were schooled because they took knowledge that they had been with Jesus. Friends, how close are you to Jesus? Because the closer you get to Jesus, a lot of Jesus rubs off on you. When you look at your children, you don't know it, but they're looking at you, they're copying you, they're imitating you, their mannerisms are like you, their language is like you, unintentionally, because they are in such close intimacy with you and you with them, a lot of you rubs off on them. Now for 3 years, Jesus lived in close intimacy with his disciples. And after Pentecost, these ordinary, unlettered, uneducated, unschooled Galilean fishermen have been transformed to be men of boldness and courage and fearlessness. Why? Because now they were infilled with a great force. And the force is the Holy Spirit. So these men, notwithstanding their inadequacies, had a message to preach. And the message is one that preached the uniqueness of Jesus. When these Sanhedrin people told them, look, don't teach or preach in the name of Jesus, Peter and John, and particularly Peter, says this in Acts chapter 4 and verse 12. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved except the name of Jesus. We find that the message is unique. All roads don't lead to Rome. There is only one way that leads back to the Father, and that's Jesus. There's no other name given among men and women and the world by which we can be saved except the name of Jesus. The uniqueness of Jesus to save and the power of the name of Jesus to save. Friends, there is power in Jesus and in the name of. The name signifies the full revelation of who Jesus is. He's not only the son of Joseph and Mary, the man of Galilee, born in Nazareth, but he's also the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity, who gave his life on a cross of Calvary in order that you and I might gain eternity. That's the Jesus that we preach. That's the Jesus of Pentecost. That's the Jesus of the 21st century. Unique, but powerful. And that's why I have no qualms in speaking boldly the word of God. For there is salvation in no one else. There is no other way back to the Father. There is no other way out of our sinful state but the way of Jesus. Believe in him and have peace. And have life. What is the motive? What is it that drove these men? Acts 1:8 says, when the Spirit comes, you will receive power. So the power for the Christian is Spirit power. That's the generator. That's the dynamo. The word is, you will receive dunamis, power, a dynamo, a dynamite. The gospel is dynamite. Last week, for us in Melbourne, we saw an iconic event taking place there, where in the Latrobe Valley there were 8 chimneys that were blasted. Dynamite blasted these 8 chimneys and it was destroyed. Now, if those dynamite explosions were deemed powerful, let me tell you that the dynamite explosion of the Spirit cannot be compared to anything physical. God can break every hardened heart. God can change every cynical mind. God can change every person who is totally, vehemently against anything that's of the Spirit. And that's why we need us, you and me, who are Christians, empowered by the Spirit, emboldened by the Spirit, enabled by the Spirit, to be able to testify, share what Christ means to us. Now, that's not easy. That's not easy. Peter and John said, now go away and don't teach or preach in the name of Jesus. Now, they could have done that. But they went back to their people and said, Lord, give us courage that we might not shut up but continue speaking. They had an inner conviction. They said, look, you decide whether it is better to obey you or to obey God. Now we're given one or two options. Obey you and don't do this, or obey God and keep on doing it. So he says, we are making a choice. And they say there is not only an inner conviction, but there is an inner compulsion. For he says, for we cannot but speak the things of God. There's a double negative. He says, we are unable not to speak. In other words, we have to speak. We must speak. We are going to speak. The inner conviction of the Spirit gives us the inner compulsion to speak the truth. And when we speak the truth about Jesus, that he is the way, the truth, and the life, no one comes to the Father except through him. So friends, my dear friends, my dearest friends, do you know Jesus? A very important question, the answer to which will determine your eternal destiny. Jesus came to give you life, to give you hope, and to give you peace. And in these days of hopelessness, may I recommend to you Jesus. In these days of fear, may I recommend to you Jesus. He came to cast out all fear. In these days of helplessness and loneliness, may I recommend to you Jesus. He's the wonderful counselor. He's the Spirit of truth. He is your comforter. He's your advocate. He pleads your case. He empowers you. He changes you and gives you meaning and purpose for living. May God give you the grace to say, Lord, I believe. Please help my unbelief. Let us pray. Oh Lord, I just want to thank you for your word. A word that tells us about life. with a capital L. A life that is ours, free of charge, in Jesus. But a life that meant a lot to you, a very costly gift to you, the gift of your Son. And Lord, on this Pentecost Sunday, once again, we are reminded of how important it is for us to know and believe that Jesus is my Lord and my Savior. That Jesus is our Lord and our Savior. Lord, the signs of the times tell us that Jesus is coming soon, has put in his own hands. But may we be ready, Lord. May we be always expecting you to come. And we will be ready for that when we know Jesus. So our prayer is that you will grant, Lord, a mighty harvest through the working of your word and your spirit to accomplish that redemptive purpose that you have for each one of us. We pray this with thanksgiving in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, grant us your peace for today and hope for all our tomorrows. And may your blessing always abide with us. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you. Grant unto all of you his amazing grace and his amazing peace. And we as God's people can say, Amen.